Let's take a closer look at the coronavirus outbreak and the issue of global pandemics from someone who knows this issue inside out. Sheri Fink is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist who works as a correspondent for The New York Times and is one of the executive producers of the documentary series Pandemic, How to Prevent an Outbreak. And I'm glad to say she joins us live on Skype this morning from New York. So, Sheri, your documentary debuted toward the end of January, just as the coronavirus outbreak was making headlines around the world. The comments section in the trailer on YouTube is ablaze with people raising suspicions about the timing of the release.
Well, and I should say it's released on Netflix for anybody who wants to see it. And of course, it took us a long time to make the documentary, so it was just a pure coincidence. But it serves to highlight the fact that pandemics can, the risk is always with us.
Yes, they pop up all the time, it's fair to say. Now we've put that issue to one side. In your series, you bring up the Spanish flu that swept the world in the late 1910s, killing tens of millions of people. That was a century ago, but viruses don't much care for humankind's scientific and medical advancements over the past century, do they?
Well, viruses are wily, and yeah, they're always changing, not just the way that they infect humans, but the way they can cause disease in all sorts of animals. And so that's why there's a lot of attention needed, cooperation between countries, and all of us have a role in trying to stop an outbreak and do the things that can help prevent us from spreading a new virus.
And your documentary is titled Pandemic, How to Prevent an Outbreak. How do you rate the response to the coronavirus outbreak? Do you think the powers that be are gradually getting better at containing such outbreaks?
Well, I'd say it's a mixed picture, right? I mean, there's no such thing as perfect preparedness, and we all know there are real gaps in terms of, everything from, resources and different countries having different abilities to address these types of outbreaks. But there's also been some real advances. So we saw today, or yesterday in your case, the World Health Organization convening scientists from all over the world trying to rapidly come up with things like vaccines. And by rapid, I mean it could still take a year. But there's a sense, I think, some development in the way that we approach this. Also, this just the common knowledge that these are threats to humanity and that there's the importance of investing in being able to detect new viruses as they jump from animals typically to humans.
Yeah, and on that point, more often than not, these pathogens leap from another animal species to humans. That's always going to be a threat, of course. But there are people out there that suggest, rightly or wrongly, that the coronavirus could have been cooked up in a lab somewhere. Are you equally concerned about an artificially man-made pathogen potentially sweeping the world?
Well, I mean, I think that to take these as separate issues. So the coronavirus, as far as I've seen in the experts I've spoken with and, the detailed work they're doing, looking at the sequence of the virus and how it relates to other known viruses in animals, there is no evidence thus far to suggest that some of these conspiracy theories are true in this case. That being said, of course, that's another scenario that preparedness officials, people who devote their lives to this type of work, and that's actually what our docu-series did, is it followed people all over the world who are trying to stop outbreaks and protect all of us. So there, of course, they look at the possibility of biological weapons as being another thing to prepare for. But you're absolutely right. The bigger risk, the risk that we all know has happened over and over again, including 1918, that we just talked about, is this link between animals and human animals.
Now, you won your Pulitzer Prize for your work covering the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. In terms of the coronavirus, though, few people are talking about how it could affect North Korea. Now, given how neglected and broken the public health system is in North Korea and its proximity to China, do you see any way North Korea avoids a serious coronavirus epidemic?
I mean, it all, I think what's really important is, things like transparency, so sharing information. All countries need to do that to stop an outbreak, because outbreaks don't respect borders. And of course, it's very important that health systems have resources to be able to fight this. So those would certainly be risks. On the other hand, as long as the virus is not circulating widely in an area, which fortunately right now, there's still the chance that we will, that the world will stop this from becoming a pandemic. So then hopefully people there will not suffer more. But certainly risks are lower resource health systems and health systems where there's not a lot of transparency in terms of sharing information.
Okay, Sheri, unfortunately, we are out of time. I know you have to shoot off for a meeting now. We appreciate your insights and best of luck with your series. We look forward to the next one. Please come back when that comes out. That was Sheri Fink, New York Times correspondent and an executive producer of the documentary series Pandemic, How to Prevent an Outbreak, available now on your favorite streaming service. Thank you.
Thank you.